Meet the Press with Hugh Remington.
Hello and welcome to Meet the Press. Now, Tony Abbott got a taste this past week of the perils of trying to be all things to all people. Speaking in Perth, he supported WA's complaints that it's not getting a fair share of GST revenue.
The GST revenue should be distributed on what is closer to a per capita arrangement. This is the unified position of the coalition premiers. I think it makes a lot of sense, and I think that's what the government should be considering.
Trouble is, per capita funding would strip hundreds of millions of dollars out of Tasmania, creating an awkward moment in that state come Thursday.
Look at what I said. I said I had sympathy. I had sympathy for the position of the coalition states. That's quite different from the words you're putting to me.
Well, can Wayne Swan be all things to all people? In his budget on Tuesday, he was certainly claiming credit for last week's interest rate cut.
Today's interest rate cut and the two before it have been made possible by disciplined fiscal policy.
But will Conservatives thank him for cutting more than $4 billion from the defence budget?
Our allies are getting weaker. It would really be a smart move if we understood the risk that we're taking in reducing defence spending.
And the welfare lobby is appalled at plans to cut benefits to sole parents.
Going after Australians who are struggling to make ends meet, who are struggling to raise their children, seems to smack of poor judgment to us.
Well, the Treasurer faces a parliament devilishly tricky in the lower house, no less so in the Senate, where the surplus fixation is not universally shared.
Yes, you need to get back to a surplus, but you need to be flexible about it.
Greens leader Christine Milne is our guest today. And later, examining his 30th federal budget, economist Chris Richardson joins us. But first, here's Imani Kitson with what's making news this Sunday, May the 6th.
Thanks, Hugh. Good morning. Opposition leader Tony Abbott has been given a boost in Parliament with Nationals MP Tony Crook formally joining the coalition. The West Australian has been on the crossbenches since entering Parliament in 2010. The move gives the coalition one more member than Labor, but Julia Gillard still has control via deals with the Independents and Greens. Parents will receive more than $800 a year for every teenager they have at high school under a bonus scheme to be unveiled today by the federal government. The means-tested payments replace the complicated education tax refund. Eligible families with primary school students will also get money. People on dental waiting lists will get a boost from the budget, with the government announcing it will inject $500 million into dental care for the poor. The money will benefit about 400,000 Australians stuck on the public waiting list because they can't afford private dental care. And the self-proclaimed mastermind of the September 11 attacks has defied a US military court in his first public appearance in more than 3 years. Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and four co-defendants repeatedly refused to respond to a judge's questions at a Guantanamo Bay hearing over the 2001 attacks. And those are the top stories this morning, Hugh.
Hermione, thank you, and welcome back to the program. Greens leader Christine Milne. Good morning, Senator.
Good morning.
Now, you're claiming a win today. The government has announced some moves on dentistry, and it seems to come straight out of your playbook.
Absolutely. It's one of the key agreements we made with the Gillard government at the time that we gave them confidence and supply. One was the multi-party climate committee to deliver carbon pricing, and the next one was a major reform in dental health across Australia.
The long-term funding of this, though, from the government, requires the Howard-era Medicare-funded dental scheme, which is now blown out to about $2 billion, to be reshaped or dumped. Are you going to support that element of it?
Well, what we've got is now this $500 million injection to clear the waiting lists, and we've also got an agreement that we will work with the government over the next 3 months to try and design a better scheme which will ultimately give universal access to dental care. The old scheme will not be repealed until the Greens and the government have reached an agreement and that there's associated funding for that agreement.
So you're not rushing to give them that funding?
We're not rushing to do that, but having said that, we're keen to make this reform. We've now delivered on the first phase of what the advisory committee wanted, and that's the blitz on the waiting lists, more training places, incentives to get dentists into rural areas. But now we want to move on to the second phase, but we won't be giving up what we've got until we've got something that the government and the Greens are happy with.
Okay, this very day we are exactly 8 weeks away from July 1 when the carbon tax comes in. We're finally getting to see who these big polluters are that we've heard so much about. The government has posted the first 250 entities of the 500 who will pay the carbon tax. Here's Greg Combe.
This is a list that's based upon the reporting of greenhouse emissions over the last 4 or 5 years by companies.
Companies, he says, but they're not just companies, are they? Because the list is here. The La Trobe University is on the list. That's not what people would normally imagine as a big polluter, is it?
Well, if they emit more than 25,000 tonnes, they're going to be out there having to look at that liability. And what it's going to do is drive all kinds of changes and new ways of doing things, new efficiencies. And I think that that's going to be very positive in the longer term.
But you've got real difficulties in the detail here, because if you look at things, there's a lot of city councils around the country. Brisbane City Council, for example, runs a large fleet of buses across Brisbane. Obviously, public transport is a good in terms of reducing overall emissions, yet it's going to be clobbered with the carbon tax in part because it runs buses. That's surely counterintuitive.
Well, public transport is great, but efficient and non-polluting public transport is even greater, and the same with a lot of local governments also operate waste services, and they too are greenhouse gas generators. So what this will do is help them to transition to a different form of fuel. So obviously in the longer term, we'd like electrification of the transport fleet. We want to see local government capturing gas and using that as an energy source and making money from it instead of just going to atmosphere. So what these things will do is actually force them to look at what the real cost of the pollution is and then take up some of the incentives and energy efficiency opportunities to transform to become more efficient and transform things that are actually wasteful into something which can be beneficial and profitable.
Excellent idea, and that's exactly the idea behind Shoalhaven Starches, which takes waste material from wheat and converts it to ethanol, a biofuel. They've just won international certification for sustainability for biofuels. You can't get greener than that. Regional New South Wales business, it's being hit with a carbon tax. Surely that wasn't your intention.
Well, anyone who is polluting, you have to be fair about this. If you're going to make rules about saying if there is a limit and above that you're going to pay, then that is the case. What we have to do is make sure that we help people to become more efficient. Now, clearly there are examples there where people say, oh, well, why would they have to pay? But we want to make sure those people who are already innovative, and clearly that company is, can even get better into the future. And I'll be looking at some of these and talking to the minister about it. But I'm confident that this is the driver to innovation. This is the driver to new jobs. People see it always in terms of the negative. We want to see it in terms of the positive.
So if you're going to talk to the minister, what might you say? Might you be looking to find some room for some companies like Shoalhaven Starches, which are all about biofuels, replacing fossil fuels with biofuels, that they might be cut a little slack?
They won't be cut any slack in terms of the threshold, but in terms of how we can facilitate the other programs, the incentivised programs, particularly in the efficiency area, in the renewables area, how can we use some of the other programs to assist government, to assist companies, to be more efficient?
So they might get a bit of extra help somehow?
Well, actually, I don't know if they're aware of the other programs that they could be using. There are lots of innovation funds, R&D funds. Let's have a look at those.
Well, manufacturing has made the point that there's been a 10% loss in manufacturing employment over the last 4 years. We've seen Toyota, 350 jobs went last month. BlueScope Steel, One Steel have lost 1,500 jobs in recent months in the manufacturing sector. They are also on the list. So these areas, if the budget is all about dealing with the two-speed economy, these are on the slow lane of the two-speed economy, about to be hit with the carbon tax. Surely that plays directly into Tony Abbott's attack line on this very legislation.
Well, let me go to the steel industry first. The stresses on the steel industry have been there for a long time, with or without the carbon price, and that is why we put through legislation, particularly to give them additional relief. And in fact, that wasn't something that Tony Abbott was keen on doing with One Steel and BlueScope, for example. Manufacturing is suffering because of the high dollar. It's also suffering because for a long time they didn't move into energy efficiency cogeneration, for example. They could have. Now there will be opportunities to take up some of those initiatives. So certainly we are looking at A, giving them assistance in terms of dealing with the high dollar and the difficulties they're facing, but also looking at ways to use the programs that we're out there introducing to assist them to make the transition. But realistically, companies are going to have to to transition, this is their opportunity to do so, and they have all been factoring in a carbon price for a long time.
OK, we're going to take a break right now. We'll be back with our journos. And, of course, it had to happen. Australia's punch-drunk politicians, now mere punchlines for comedians.
I am going out with Peter Slipper.
Oh, yes.
And Craig Thompson.
Right.
To King's Cross, a place. Craig is said he is paying for it all.
And you won't have to spend any money on a cab to get there either.
Oh, really? Why? He is a cab driver?
No, Peter will take care of that.
This is Slippery Beat.
Yes.
I'm thinking of offering him a post in my government.
Oh, wow.
You know, maybe head of the sexual harassment department.
Quite an esteemed position in Wadi, right?
Well, it does. There is a lot of harassment and very few hours in the day.